morning, good morning. Am I on? Anybody? Can you hear anything? Nope. Let's first check for user error. That would be me. No? It's green. It's green. Well, we'll make sure we get there. So, welcome to Emmanuel. I'm Pastor Thiemann. Great to be here this morning. Pastor Nathan is on vacation, and Pastor Bob is helping out at Holy Cross for the next couple of months until they get a pastor. So this week, I'm at Laura's on vacation. Anybody want to do the children's message this morning? Okay. All right, we will, I'm sure, get along. Ladies, thank you so much for the beautiful music to get us started this morning. We continue our sermon series, our storyline, and this week's story is the story of Saul becoming Paul. And as always, we want to insert ourselves in the story. So we'll talk about how you too could be on fire for the Lord. Many of you already are. All of us are to a degree, but we want to see how we can pump up the heat a little bit with that. One thing to look forward to this week, Saturday, is the clinic. So if you signed up to help, hallelujah, we need you. If you haven't, and if you are available Saturday, sign up to help. You can go online to do that. Go to Emmanuel's website or see Bob Dorn at the end of the service today. We have a spot for you. I'm sure we can plug you in to be here to help. It's a great day. It's a great opportunity to serve. It's what we do for the community to help out many people who otherwise would not receive medical services and other things we take for granted like haircuts and things of that nature. So if you can be here, help us out on Saturday. As always, fill out your connection card, put it in the offering basket later on in the service. So with that, let's all rise and welcome everyone to the Lord's house. name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Please take a moment of silence to reflect upon your week. Remember those things that did not go as you intended, the things that you did wrong, the thoughts that were not God-pleasing, the words that were not edifying. Lift those up to the Lord, knowing that He is faithful and just, and He will indeed forgive your sin. Let us then together confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord God, bless your word wherever it is proclaimed. Make it a word of power and peace to convert those not yet your own and to confirm those who have come to saving faith. May your word pass from the ear to the heart, from the heart to the lips, and from the lips to the life as you have promised. Your word may achieve the purpose for which you send it, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated for our anthem, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Thank you, Linda, Bonnie. Thank you very much for preparing us for our worship today with the beautiful music. It's time now to hear our story for the day, and Kimberly Schumacher will be reading that for us today.
Good morning. Scripture reading today is from Acts chapter 9. But Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogue at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now as he went on his way, he approached Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. And falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and enter the city, and you will be told what to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the voice, but seeing no one. Saul rose from the ground, and although his eyes were opened, he saw nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him to Damascus. And for 3 days he was without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And the Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias?" And he said, "Here I am, Lord." And the Lord said to him, "Rise and go to the street called Straight, and the house of Judas, and look for a man of Tarsus named Saul, for behold, he is praying. And he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he's done to your saints at Jerusalem. And here he has the authority from the chief priests to bind all who call on your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles and the kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer for my sake." So Ananias departed and entered the house, and laying his hands on him, said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road by which you came, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately, something like scales fell from his eyes, and he regained his sight. Then he rose and was baptized, and taking food, he was strengthened. For some days he was with the disciples at Damascus, and immediately he proclaimed Jesus in the synagogue, saying, "He is the Son of God." And all who heard him were amazed and said, "Is this not the man who made havoc in Jerusalem of those who called upon his name? And has he not come here for this purpose, to bring them bound before the chief priests?" But Saul increased all the more in strength and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
I'd like to invite the children to come forward this morning for the children's message. Kids, come on up. Well, good morning. We're going to try that again. I'm going to say good morning, and you're going to say with your best Sunday morning voice, "Good morning, Pastor Tiemann." Can you do that? All right. Good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning, Pastor
Tiemann. I don't feel warm and fuzzy yet. All right. Good enough. So we're going to talk a little bit about Saul today, but we have a couple of things. What are these? Does anybody know what these are called? What are these? These are vases. And I have a variety of them. I'll put them out here so you can see them. If you were to guess, and there's no real wrong answer here, but if you were to look, I have four different ones. If you were to look at these, which one do you think would be the most expensive? Do you think? This one probably, right? This is crystal. Now, let's say that this was a very expensive piece of glass that's crystal. Let's say that it was something that was a family heirloom. An heirloom is something that is passed down from generation to generation. Maybe it was a great-grandmother's, and then it was given to her daughter, your grandmother, and then it was given to your mother. And someday it might then even become yours. So it could be very old, it could be very expensive, and it's very, very special. So it should have a nice place in your home. Maybe it goes on the kitchen table and you fill it with water and you put pretty flowers in it, right? So you could do that. So I have some pretty flowers here this morning. Some sunflowers, which are beautiful this time of the year, unless, of course, they're growing in your cornfield. You don't like them so much, but they're good on the table. But what's my problem here? What is it? The vase is way too small. They're not going to fit, are they? Maybe one I could get in there, and it's even a kind of a tight fit, right? So even though I have a beautiful vase, and it's very special, and it's very expensive, it really doesn't fit the purpose, does it? So I probably should use something else. Do you see any other vases that might work? This one? Yeah, this one is wide enough, but what's the problem with this one? It's a little short, isn't it? So it doesn't fit the best. So probably this one, even this one could work, but it's a little flimsy. So this is probably the best one, isn't it? And that would work out just fine. I'll put some water in it later, and we'll put it there on the kitchen table so it has a very special place. Well, the reason that I brought the vase is because we're kind of like that. We're a vessel. We are someone that can hold a purpose. Now, it's not to hold flowers like the vase, but when we heard the story of Saul, his purpose was to share the love of Jesus. And he did that throughout his life after he changed from being an enemy of God to being his friend, even his child. The very same thing has happened to each one of us, not just our children, but all of us. We're going to talk more about this in the sermon, about how we were once an enemy of God, like Saul was, always fighting against him, but now we have become his child and his friend, and God gives us a very special purpose. We all look different. If you look around, you see that everyone is a little different. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Today is the story of Saul's conversion, a man on fire. Take a look at your sermon notes and you can follow along with me today. It begins like this. It says, "Nothing surprises me anymore." Do you have any surprises anymore in your life? You know, about the time that I say nothing surprises me significant. You just have to be number one because we're only living for this life. Number two, I'm still going to put in the crucifixion. Jesus has to pay for our sin. So number two, the power of the Holy Spirit came on the disciples. The time there were only a handful of believers. After Pentecost, you read the entire book of Acts. You go from this handful of believers to the entire Roman Empire being saturated with the Word of God. Very significant. And then number four, which is what we're going to talk about today, this event gets more ink in the New Testament than any other event besides the death of Jesus. Three times in the book of Acts, we hear the story repeated. And here in Acts chapter 9, we just heard the story, the conversion of Saul. So now let's put this in historical context. This would be the equivalent of a headline in 1944. So think back, 1944, what's going on in world history? It is the rise of Hitler and the Nazis in Germany. So this is the equivalent of Saul, who is a Jew and a Pharisee, a Hebrew blue blood from the tribe of Benjamin, someone who has been educated at the finest university in the world, who is immersed in Greek culture, who is also a Roman citizen, and knows the pagan culture as well. He now converts to Christianity. It's the equivalent of Hitler becoming a Jew. Someone who is exterminating 6 million people. That's exactly what Saul was doing. He was the guy who was there when the first Christian martyr, Stephen, was stoned to death. He was a guy who was holding all the coats and the cloaks of those who had picked up the rocks so that they could get a little extra on their fastball. Now he has letters from the high priest in Jerusalem. He's traveling up to Damascus, 150 miles away, and anyone that he suspects at all who is a follower of the way, that's what Christianity was called at the time. Why? Because Jesus said, I am the way. The only way to the Father. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father, Jesus said, except through me. Saul is breathing fire and murderous threats, the equivalent of Hitler. He was the proverbial immovable object. He will not be swayed until this encounter on the road to Damascus. With the greatest force on earth, which is, number one, what was it again? The resurrected Christ. So, that's what we're going to look at today, but as always, in these stories, I want you to insert yourself in the story. And you are Saul, and you become Paul. So the question that I want you to ask yourself this morning is this: is my Christian faith a raging fire like Paul's becomes, which consumes the entire Roman kingdom? Or is my faith just a dull habit, a little flicker that I exercise routinely, maybe on a Sunday morning? That's the question. So let's take a look at the event. Number two. The light changes everything. Everything is changed here on the road to Damascus. We have from the text, but Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to